And you've seen the core. You can imagine you've got some data set and you've used the dollar core terms to describe your data. Now, what's the best way to share that data? Okay? So what I'm going to talk to you about is another standard for sharing the information contained in the data set. It's called dollar core outcome. So there's been some questions. What's the difference between ABCD? ABCD and dollar core? Well, here's a big difference right there. ABCD contains over 1,200 different concepts. And they're related to one another. The data format where it's exchanged is XML. And quite often the protocol used to exchange it is biodiversity. I'm not going to go into too much detail on what those are. But the key here is it's got over 1,200 different terms to help you describe your data set. And that can be a bit overwhelming. So the good thing about dollar core is it's a smaller number of terms. You can see 172 is how many it contains today. 157 in just a simple dollar core. And this is exchanged in simple text files, CSV, TAP delimited formats. And the way that this is most often shared is something called the dollar core archive. So let me get into what that is exactly. It just allows the information based on dollar core terms to be shared via simple text files. It itself is defined by a standard, and in your own spare time you can check out this funny video about the standard. But we're really just talking about, you know, how to share your data set in a very simple, efficient way. In your data, when we're talking about biodiversity data, it's either primary biodiversity data, occurrence data, or taxonomic data, species names. And whenever you're sharing your data set, it's absolutely essential that you also share what's called metadata. So information about what your data set contains. So, here's the complete package. In the middle, you've got your core file, okay? Either taxon or occurrence. Then you've got your metadata document. You've got a descriptive file, which handles the mapping of your columns to dollar core terms. And the final result is a compressed, zipped dollar core archive. So imagine you've got all these text files, XML files, in one folder, zipped together to dollar core archive. It's not very complicated, and relative to other protocols for exchanging biodiversity information, it's extremely simple. There's no web services involved. There's not more than 1,000 terms to choose from. It's simple. That's the key that I'm trying to drive home right now. Okay? So it's a simple format for exchanging the data. It's efficient for harvesters to go and crawl and index, because ultimately it's just a zip folder, it's one file, it's very easy to download. It's efficient to store because it's compressed, it's zipped. Everything together, one folder, zipped. So it doesn't take up as much space on your computer, right? So, it's just a simple folder, so there's no special software or tools that are really needed to share this information. You just put your file on your server at a public address where it's downloadable, and you're done. And it's very extensible. So 172 terms of our core. You can have these extensions to define the data so that your data can be represented in a star schema, so many to one relationships, and I'll get into that a little bit later too. And ultimately, this is the number one format that publishers are sharing their data in right now in the GBIF network. And so it is the preferred format for publishing biodiversity data sets in the network right now. So I'm going to go through the individual components one by one now, okay? So first, you've got a metadata file, and we use the ecological markup language. It's a meta standard for describing dataset metadata to describe your metadata. So what kind of metadata about your dataset must you include? Well, it's always a good idea to have a title and a description of what your dataset is. Citation, the main contact, authors of the data, the geographic scope, the different sampling methods, bibliography, and so on and so forth. It's quite rich, and similar to what we were talking about with describing your data set with as many fields as possible, you want to try and do the same thing with your metadata. So, the next component is your core file. For people working in spreadsheets, imagine it's just your primary spreadsheet table, but it's a text file. It's a CSV file. It's either taxon or occurrence. And so here's a couple examples, all right? The first one is a core file based on taxonomic information. So it's got some classification there. And so now you're starting to see some of the things that John was talking about before. It's got an ID, so one record per row. Kingdom, biome, it's got the classification organized according to the global core terms. Down here, it's a sample from a core file based on occurrences. Looks a little bit different. Again, it's just a different subset of terms for either the taxon core or the occurrence core. But again, these column names, these are dollar core names. Institution code, collection code, catalog number, scientific name. So quickly, some best practices about how to make these core files. Your data should have an identifier for each row. It uniquely identifies that row in the entire data set. It may not be globally unique, it may not even be universally unique, but at the very least, it must be unique within your own data set. And we're trying to prevent as much duplicate records inside your data set as possible. So, we skipped over John's mapping exercise, but effectively what you're going to be doing is something like this. You've got your own column names here, okay? Maybe just to save space in your spreadsheet, you decided to use king instead of kingdom, by instead of bio. Maybe you're giving your own ID, something that's more relevant to you and the people in your team. So here is a collection of dollar core terms. Now, in order to publish a dollar core archive, you need to tell people what the relationship is between the dollar core terms and the terms that you've used in your own medicine. For terms that don't match dollar core, such as wingspan. Correct me if I'm wrong, John, but I don't think there's anything in the dollar core terms for wingspan. So in this case, it's fine. You can include it in your data set. You don't need to remove all this rich information that might not necessarily matter. We hope that everything matches, but if it doesn't match, that's okay. You can stay in there. So don't worry, you don't have to do that. And there's a couple different ways that you can ultimately match your columns to dollar code terms. One is you can just simply go in there and you can rename everything. Or alternatively, you can use a meta.xml file. It's an XML descriptive file which contains the mappings. So for example, this was our species ID down here in position 0. And that's our dollar core term in taxon ID. And so these mappings are contained in this file. Now, I'm not going to recommend that you publish any of these XML files by hand. We have tools to help you do this so that you avoid making mistakes. And it's also a little confusing that you have an XML dataset descriptive file called meta.xml, and you've got a metadata file called EML. Try not to get confused by those two things. The meta.xml file has the mappings that match the columns in the four data file to dollar code. All right, so the next thing in that big diagram, the anatomy of what is a dollar code archive, is that the core file can have an extension. So out of these 172 terms in dollar core, perhaps it doesn't allow for some of the other things that you would like to publish. And it also is a more convenient way to share that information in a more organized manner. So in this example up here, we've got our taxon core file again. And we've got an extension file called commonnames.txt that has vernacular names specifying the language that they are in and how they relate back to each row in our core file. So in this example, our very first row with taxon ID has two vernacular names, two common names in English specified in this extension file. And extensions, they're not just limited to common names, to vernacular names. There's a large pool of different extensions available to publishers today. And we've got a lot of bases covered, and there's some things that are in testing. I think there's one for Audubon, for example, describing rich resource media information. And this is how it looks. So you've got your core file, you can have multiple common names to one record. To fill out the example a little bit more, I've included another extension file called descriptions. So imagine you've got multiple descriptions about each taxon. And similar to how the meta file described which dollar code term is related to which columns inside your species file, the meta.xml file does the same thing for the extensions file. So this is just a large mapping file, and it relates to all the core file, the core files, and the extension files inside your file. So, putting it all together, through the Darwin Co-Archive, all those different components inside a single directive called version. We've got our core file, we've got our metadata XML descriptive file, we've got our metadata file, and we've got two extension files. They're all contained in a single folder. And I'm sure all you guys know how to do this. You take a folder, you compress it into a zip folder. So for myself and my Mac, I just go compress and it uploads that zip folder. On Windows, which I see a lot of you guys use, it might be the WinZip utility. And that's the end result. So now you've got your DALL info archive, it's got your data set, it's got your metadata about your data set, and it contains all the mapping information. Now how do you share that information? For example, how does GBIF come and crawl your data set and index it into the worldwide index? Well, very simply, you want to just make this publicly available on your web. And you can just drop that onto your server. That access point URL gets registered so that you're aware of where it is to find it. Go into a lot of that on day 4, I believe. But there's no need to do these things by hand. You've got tools to help you do this. There's something called GBIF spreadsheet templates. So you've got a series of templates that will help you publish metadata-only data sets, that will help you publish occurrence data sets, and simple species checks. We've also got the IPT, and we'll be dedicating a lot of time to this tool on day 4. And just a very brief introduction, this is an open source Java application. It sits on a web server. And it's a very easy way to manage multiple data sets. The spreadsheets, they're better just as a single data set, a single publisher with a single data set. And the IBT is better for museums, larger institutions, having multiple departments, multiple researchers. And this one, it doesn't have a very high technical threshold to learn how to use, but it's definitely a lot more than just a simple Excel spreadsheet, which many of you will probably already use. And so the demonstration that will follow, I don't know if we have time for before lunch, we'll probably have an after lunch. So we're running out of time. It's going to be how to create a DALL info archive using these spreadsheet templates. And we'll walk through it very slowly together. And at the end of that exercise, we'll all have produced your very own DALL info archive. Something I mentioned earlier today is that it's our job to stand up here and tell you what the recommended ways of doing things, the easiest ways of doing things, that are going to save your time and your patience. And again, depending on your situation, I would recommend that you use these spreadsheet templates because it's already familiar technology to you. I would recommend IPT because of a lot of investment gone into developing this tool to make it as easy as possible to, for example, upload source data and map it to our own terms and publish it to the developer. And I will briefly mention this hosting center option, which is if you're really interested in using the IBT, but your home institution doesn't have the technical capacity, the server capacity to be able to host this application, then there's institutions around the world that make it easy
such people not having that technical capacity to go and use the tool and publish some information. And even forces different combinations of features. But this is really how I would recommend publishing your biodiversity data set.